That potato is creamy. I can taste the spiciness of the chili that's gone into flavor that potato. And the flavors of that kanda lasun chutney. Get some of the farsan on our usli. Get some of the onions too. Mix it all together. Some of the misal with the pav to make it the misal pav. Puran poli without the ghee.
Without the ghee.
Is incomplete. So if you're doing a puran poli, you have to do that sajuk tup. And the sweetness of the shrikhand gets to you. That puri comes in handy to rein in some of that sweetness, some of that mithas, or as the Maharashtrians would say, some of that godapan. Hi folks, this is Kripal Amana, Gourmet on the Road, and you're watching Food Lovers TV. I hope you're doing well. For those of you who know about me, you perhaps know that I spent many years in Maharashtra, more specifically Mumbai, or Bombay as it was called then. I grew up in Mumbai and also had the opportunity to travel a bit around Maharashtra, but this was years ago. So every once in a while, I think of the food, more specifically the street food that I used to enjoy in Maharashtra. Basically things like vada pav, misal pav and such like. And when I think of those dishes, I also crave those dishes. So every once in a while, I like to indulge in some Maharashtrian street food. We've done a couple of episodes on Maharashtrian food in the channel. If you haven't caught them yet, I'll probably place a link here and also in the description below. Today we're going to visit an eatery in HSR layout, not too far from our setup in Koramangala, where they do some Maharashtrian street style food. And the name of this eatery is Mast Marathi. So let's go check this place out and hopefully taste some mast Maharashtrian food. Let's go. Namaskar.
Welcome.
Kaise hai tumhi?
Badhiya. Namaste.
Mast. Mast, of course, because we are in
Mast Marathi.
Mast Marathis. So it has to be mast. Mast means fantastic.
Fantastic. Yeah. I am Swati.
I'm Shekhar.
Swati and Shekhar.
Yeah.
So you began Mast Marathi together.
Yes. Being a Marathi, ये मज़ा प्रोफेशन होता.
ओके.
तो सो आई वांटेड टू ब्रिंग द मराठी फूड टू बेंगलोर.
आणि तुम्ही बेंगलोर किती वर्ष आहे आता?
बेंगलोर मध्ये सर 15 वर्ष.
15 वर्ष. दॅट मीन्स स्वाती इज नाऊ अ बेंगलोरियन. अँड व्हॉट अबाउट यू?
कन्नडिगा.
यू आर अ कन्नडिगा. अँड वेअर आर यू ओरिजिनली फ्रॉम?
फ्रॉम चंद्रपूर नियर नागपूर.
ओह, फॅन्टॅस्टिक. That's an interesting combination. And what brought you to Karnataka, if I may ask?
He brought me to Karnataka.
Ah, okay.
We both are actually from IT Bangalore. She's also from IT Bangalore. I'm also from IT Bangalore. And she quit for this passion.
So, deed varshas aale. Now you've been here 15 years.
Yeah.
Do you know Kannada?
Yeah, sir.
Of course. Kannada barate?
Barate.
That's nice. That's an interesting combination. Shekhar went from Bengaluru to Chandrapur, met Swati, bought her here, and now they have Mast Marathi. So the recipes that you're doing here at Mast Marathi, what is the food about here?
It's all hand-picked Maharashtrian food here. Nostalgic food.
Nostalgic food.
So somebody from Maharashtra comes, feels nostalgic here. And somebody from Bangalore, for them it's something new and to explore.
So basically the food here is some of your favorites.
Favorites of Maharashtra.
Favorites of Maharashtra. I also like your curtains here. That's a
Paithani sari.
Paithani sari.
It comes from Maharashtra.
From Maharashtra. Yeah. So can we take a look at the kitchen and see what's happening?
Sure.
So when you talk about Maharashtrian food, ladi pav paije, it's na?
Sir, ami sakali order karto sandhyakal paryanta purna khali hote
mag. So kiti packet?
Ite 10 packet
hai. 10 packet.
Pratyek packet madhe 24.
So 240. Pavs will go out by the end of the day. Either in the vada pav,
misal pav. We have pav bhaji, we have dabeli.
Dabeli pan aaye. Okay, fantastic. That's a khichdi happening.
Yes, sabudana khichdi. Jo ghee mein ban raha hai.
Made in ghee.
Yes.
What is he making on the side
He's
of that?
Making bhakri. Jowar bhakri.
Jowar bhakri. So So what do you serve with a bakri?
With bakri we serve pitla. Jhunka. That's like a nostalgic for any.
Pitla manje kaya?
Pitla manje besan cha curry
hai. Ah, okay.
And jhunka hai. They pan besan cha hai, but in a thick format.
Correct.
And we have masala wangi.
Bangan.
Masala bangan.
Barley wangi. Oh, okay. So once it's fried on that, then it's puffed up. On the flame.
Yes. Like a typical like what ragi mudde is for Karnataka. This is pitla bakri is for Maharashtra.
And of course you take that onion, you pound it.
Correct.
And you have it with the
green chili thesa.
So what did you think of this food when you first tasted it?
Awesome.
A Karnataka eating bisi pehle baat, idli vade.
We have been living in Bangalore and been used to ragi mudde, other things. Tasting a different food. And it is a gluten free.
It's a healthy food.
Correct, it's healthy food. So, manje Maharashtrian food mate, that green chili plays a pivotal role, no?
Yes, green chili and red chili also.
Green chili and red chili also.
The color.
You know, that thesa looks inconspicuous almost on that thali. But when you place even a tiny bit of it on your tongue, that thesa suddenly opas everything else. And that's why I guess you need to combine that with the jowar roti and the pitla to tone down its fiery presence.
There are multiple variation of pitla.
Okay.
We make pitla with dahi, we make pitla with kakdi.
What is happening there?
We are making thalipit. Oh. So this is made up of a thalipit bhajni. A typical bhajni which has jawar, which has rice, bajra, some dals, chana dal, dhania powder, jeera powder.
So it's very wholesome.
It's a multi-grain kind of a thing. Again, it is a gluten-free here.
Gluten-free.
Yeah.
But thalipit has more flavor that comes from green chilies.
Correct.
From some onions and things like that.
Yes.
Coriander.
So onion is a very important vegetable in Maharashtra. So without onion, we can't make anything. This is a very wholesome food, very healthy food. I mean, this can be eaten for breakfast, for lunch, for dinner. It's light as well as, you know,
nutritious. And why do you make a hole there in the thali?
That is a typical look of a thali pit. It has to cook in the center.
And then I noticed that he also put some oil in that. So that ensures that it's cooked through and through.
Yes. A typical masala box any Maharashtrian kitchen will have. So this is a spicy chili powder. This is Guntur chili powder.
Oh, use Guntur chili.
This is for the color. Badige chili powder. This is haldi powder. This is salt. This is pav bhaji masala. This is dhania powder. This is goda masala.
Goda masala. How many ingredients go into the goda masala?
Around 20.
20.
So 20 ingredients.
Do you make the masala or do you procure that?
We procure from Maharashtra.
You procure from Maharashtra. I guess it's a complex.
Complex thing, sir. So we have to get that authentic test.
So does the goda masala go into almost every preparation?
Almost everything, sir. Almost all the curries what we make here. It has a different color in different regions. In Vidarbha region, it is little dark, kala masala kind of.
I see that the goda masala here is not very dark.
It's from Sangli.
From Sangli.
Yes.
Because I see that the color here is a lot lighter.
Yes. This is a kanda lassi.
So the vada pav is happening.
Yes.
The batata vada.
It's a very popular vada pav.
Every next order is vada pav.
Every next order is a vada pav.
And we give in jodi. We don't give single vada pav.
So don vada.
Don vada.
What makes a good batata vada?
Sir, we have a vada pav chutney which is mixed with the aloo. So in that chutney, all the flavors are there. The chili, the garlic, the dhania.
Oh, that's how it gets its color.
That's the color.
There's other things that I see that are
curry leaves.
Curry leaves.
We have ginger garlic.
And that is besan and some.
Besan and haldi, salt.
And
we
salt.
We don't put soda also here. Sir, ye puran hai. This has a chana dal, gud, and jaifal.
And this, of course, is the.
This is the atta for puran. Atta plus little maida.
Atta and little maida. What I notice here is that your chefs are not typically Maharashtrian, but. They seem to be doing the Maharashtrian food with a lot of expertise. What's your name?
Dipen Lama.
Where are you from?
Darjeeling.
And you're doing Maharashtrian food. Kitna saal ho gaya?
4-5 years.
5 saal. Achha lagta hai Maharashtrian food?
Yes, sir.
Darjeeling, spice wagera?
Darjeeling mein spicy nahi chalega.
Haan.
Spicy, other job.
Fantastic. So this is true integration. So Lama here comes from Darjeeling. He works with them. She comes from Nagpur, he of course is from Bengaluru, and they are together doing Maharashtrian food. So So even that rolling has to be very skillfully done, because you don't want the puran, which is a stuffing, to come out of the poli.
Correct.
So there is no oil that goes into it?
No, because the flavor shouldn't be mixed oil and ghee.
Alright. Puran poli without the ghee.
Without the ghee.
Is incomplete.
Of course.
And not the ghee. In Marathi, it's a tup.
Tup. Sajuk tup.
Sajuk tup. Sajuk manje kai pure.
Pure tup.
So if you're doing a puran poli, you have to do that sajuk tup. You know, when I heard of this place first, I'd heard of the misal pav, the vada pav, etc. But when I look at the menu here, it's quite a substantial menu. So you have the snacky faral. So the faral are the snacks in Marathi. But then you also have plenty of options for jevan. So you have the bhakri, you have the rice, you have the varan bhat, the kolhapuri dal, a veg thali. And then of course you also have the upvasti faral, which is basically the sabudana khichdi and things like that. So I think no matter what your Maharashtrian craving, whether you're craving something light, some faral, or something substantial in the form of jevan, I think you'll find it here. You know, kokum has this sourness, but a very typical sourness. For want of a better word, I find it quite funky in its sourness. Also in the aromas that you nose. I think out here it makes for a good combination with the soda, because the soda has the effervescence and the kokum has the sourness, and there's some sugar syrup that's gone into it, though not too much. My vada pav is here. That pav certainly feels right. And then you have the kanda lasan chutney that's smeared on the inside and the chili. So typically they use a chili called a lavangi, and I'm told that the lavangi here goes into a chili paste that goes to flavor the potatoes. You know, when you talk about a good pav, you want that pav to have strength. And that's certainly the sort of texture that I'm feeling in this pav. You want that pav to have some strength. You don't want the pav to be fluffy. A fluffy pav is a Bengaluru pav, but the actual pav is that kadak pav. When I say kadak, not crisp, it's a pav that has strength like this particular pav here. And what I like already is the fact that as I press the vada with the pav, the skin that's encasing the vada has already torn, because that besan flour, that batter, should serve only to contain the potatoes within that vada. It should not come in the way of your tasting the vada. That potato is creamy. I can taste the spiciness of the chili that's gone into flavor that potato. And the flavors of that kanda lasan chutney. It's sharp in its spiciness, but also quite warming. My misal pav is also here. I think I'm going to finish my vada pav before I take a look at that misal pav. I've consumed most of that chili. So that's a salted fried chili. And the chili gets to you, go for some of that pav. That pav with its weighty, starchy character also serves to offset some of that chili heat. I love the freshness of the coriander that I'm also tasting in that batata vada. And what's nice here, the potatoes are stained a light yellowish green. And what I'm told is that they make a masala with some chilies, with some coriander and a few other things that go in to flavor the potato. And some curry leaves as well. I have a sweet chutney and a spicy chutney here, but to be honest, I don't really see the need for that. I'm quite content savoring this vada pav on its own. Aloo bhaji and the kanda bhaji. Well, now to give company to my misal pav, I also have these bhaji pav. And this takes me right back to the streets of Mumbai. So you had the vada pav, which of course is the original offering. But then you also have these pakoras of sorts, and those were also stuffed into the pav with the kanda lasan chutney and the chili, and that became the bhaji pav. And this is with potatoes, so it's basically sliced potato that's lightly flavored with some chili powder, some salt, and then dipped in that batter and then fried. And out here you have the bhaji pav, but this is with the onion pakoda. So this is what the vada pav evolved to in Mumbai. And I distinctly remember tasting these
at most street corners in the city. So I think that's a beautiful thing about food. So the vada pav is a down and out Maharashtrian creation. But I think the people who would ply the trade, who would run those vada pav gadis, I think many of them came from different parts of the country. And they evolved that vada pav offering into something else altogether. And therefore you have variations of the bhaji pav, whether it's the potatoes or the onions. That looks like a flavorful pakoda. I can see tons of coriander, onions. And the onion has this deep, savory, fried flavor. I think I'm going to hold back from the chili for a bit. What I like about the pav is this. Even though you press that bhaji in with that pav doesn't tear. That pav has strength. You know, soft, crunchy sweetness of the fried onions. Some warmth from that chili that you taste. Also some coriander in there somewhere, some cumin perhaps. And the freshness of the fresh coriander. This is a flavor that takes me right back to Mumbai. So a vada pav is soft and creamy, the batata vada. Whereas this bhaji pav is crisp and crunchy. So although this has the kanda lasan, which is spicy in itself, because it's got plenty of onions, it doesn't register too much when it comes to that spicy warmth. Because I'm not sweating as much at the back of my head when I'm eating this kanda bhaji pav, as opposed to that vada pav with that kanda lasan chutney and also that chili. Well, let me go for a bite of that potato bhaji pav. And in this one, I think we're going to retain the chili, because I expect this to be slightly blander as opposed to that onion pakoda. And you need some of that chili spice. That's a big mouthful. The Bombay or the Mumbai burger, the original Mumbai burger, the vada pav in its variation, the bhaji pav. You know, after tasting the full-on flavors of that kanda bhaji pav, it's a tough act for the potato to follow, because the potato doesn't have too much flavors of its own. There's a bit of chili somewhere there. That besan, the batter, also has some turmeric in that, but it's rather difficult for it to play catch up in its flavors when compared to that kanda bhaji pav. So as you can see, there's not much here in terms of the flavor. You got the potato and you got the besan. And I think this is probably the opportune moment to taste some of that chutney. We have two chutneys here. That is a sweet chutney made of tamarind and a coriander mint chutney. I think let's combine both the chutneys in our next bite of that aloo bhaji pav. And that's where the chutneys finally make their presence felt. So you got the sweet acidity of that tamarind chutney and that perky, minty, refreshing spice of that green chutney. My pick though of the two bhaji pav is definitely the kanda bhaji pav. And of course, you have to do that batata vada pav. And that chili certainly helps. I think time to taste the misal pav. So the misal pav is a combination of a few things. It's actually a melange of items that come together. So first, of course, you have the usuli, which is a gravy which is made of the moth bean or the matki. And what you see floating on top is the cut, is the spicy oil. And that is what conveys the spiciness of that preparation. You have some farsan that's served on the side and some onions and lemon as well. When you combine the farsan into the usuli, and the cut along with some onions with a drizzle of lime and eat it with the pav, then it becomes the misal pav. I want to taste that matki first just by itself. The matki by itself is quite mellow in its flavors. What I like is that the moth bean has a bit of a crunch, but then that oil, that cut is the sort that grips your throat with its spicy personality. And you can certainly taste that, the chili heat in that cut. I think what we should do is get some of the farsan on our usuli. get some of the onions too. Mix it all together. You want to allow for that farsan to soak up the usli, to be tainted an orangish red by that cut. You want to, in a manner of speaking, tone down the spicy fervor of the cut. Actually round its spicy personality a tad. You know, to me, a misal is a playful medley of flavors and textures. So you have that nourishment of the moth bean, the madgi that you bite into, and then you have the spicy fervor of that cut. And the farsan initially appeals to your palate with its spicy crunch. So you're biting into different things as you taste a spoonful of that misal. So first you have the soft bite of the madki or the moth beans, then you have the crunch of the farsan, and then somewhere in there, the moist bite of the onions. But as the farsan spends more time soaking up that usli, the farsan also soaks up the spicy fervor of the cut. And now I can taste the farsan too is beginning to soften a wee bit. Some of the misal with the pav to make it the misal pav. I like to soak my pav in such that the pav is weighed down by the usli and the farsan and the onions. And as you place the pav in your mouth, that pav disintegrates, leaving on your tongue a pool of that spicy usli and some of that farsan. And if you like, you can also add a zing of lime to your misal. This spoon here conveys all the components of a perfect misal. You've got that madki, you've got the moth beans, you've got the crunch of the onions there, you've got the farsan that has now soaked up that gravy and that cut, and all of that comes together to convey that comforting, spicy hit of a misal. And what I can also taste in there, as my palate is now familiar with the spicy tones, I can also taste some of the masala that's probably gone into it. The character of some of the aromatic spices that have gone into the masala. Perhaps the goda masala too, that finds its way into most of the dishes here. I can feel that spicy hit at the back of my throat. That spicy hit of the cut. The pav serves as a perfect medium to cocoon all the components and flavors of that misal. I think now that we're done with the faral sort of items, the snacky items, I think let's get to our jevan here. So what do we have? So we have the bhakri, which is made of jawar. So for those of you who also want to taste something gluten-free, well, this is it. Gluten-free bread made with jawar. And with this is the pitla. The pitla, which is basically made of besan. There's some green chilies that go into it. I'm told some coriander, etc. Some salt also. And the combination with the pitla is the thecha. The thecha is the spicy green chili that's pounded with some salt. And the onion as well. And then you have the thalipeet. So the thalipeet, I think, has more things going in it. So it's a combination of different grains, some lentils too that go into it, some onions, some green chilies, some cumin, etc. So that's a flavorful bread. And along with the thalipeet, you serve the curds, the yogurt, and also some loncha or the pickle. I think I'm going to make a beginning though with the bhakri. There's a comforting, lightest wail of some sweetness that I taste in that bhakri. I love the aromas of the flour, of the jawar flour that's wafting through my mouth. If you were to give this to me hot, I could eat it just by itself. It's as comforting as that. I'm going to taste it now with that pitla. So that's the classic combination. So that pitla has a comforting warmth to it. It's moist, so it serves to moisten the bhakri. Green chilies that go into it, but the green chilies aren't too vociferous in the way they speak to your palate. What you're tasting though is certainly the freshness of that coriander, because that bhakri is quite singular in its flavors. That's where that pitla and the thecha and onions come in. to add a bit of complexity and a bit of variation to the flavors that you taste. And of course, there's also plenty of peanuts that go into that thetsa. I love that thetsa. When I tasted it first, I tasted a bit of the green chili and the salt. But now I'm also tasting the crunch of the peanuts, the shenga. Well, that's delicious. I know I'm going to pay the price for relishing that thetsa with such gay abandon, but that thetsa is delicious. I think this time, let's go for plenty more of the thetsa and with a bit of that pitla. Initially, you're tasting the comforting moistness of that pitla. And suddenly, from somewhere in there, you bite into the nutty and that chili strong fervor of that thetsa. If you love to taste something spicy, definitely try plenty of this thetsa. So the bhakri is traditional farmer food in Maharashtra. What they would do is pound the onion. Of course, the farmers are much stronger than I am. Go for some of that bhakri with the onion and some of that thetsa. That moist pungency of the onion complements the spicy, nutty notes of that thetsa rather well. There's some of the onions here and also that thetsa with the shenga. So this is typical farmer food. So I guess when the farmer went to the fields in the morning, all he got with him was some bhakri, some thetsa, maybe an onion and some pitla. And when he was done with his work for the morning, he would sit down under a shade somewhere, open his lunch bundle and make a meal of this. I think let's make tracks for that thali peet now. Of course, the thali peet also gets a mollycoddling of the butter. You know, the flavor of this thali peet is quite complex because there's a variety of grains that go into it. So you have some jowar that goes into it, you perhaps have some wheat that goes into it, some gram flour too, perhaps some millet, some rice flour. So I think everybody has a combination of grains that go into it, and that's what lends it a complex flavor. And what brings that together are the fresh ingredients that find their way into the dough. So you got plenty of coriander, there's some onions that are diced finely, some chilies as well, some cumin. And that's going to make for a delicious bite with all that butter. You know, what's great about both these plates is that it's packed in wellness. It's packed in its nutrition. A gluten-free bread for those who would like something Spartan, something slightly simple. Or if you want something flavorful, that's where the thali peet comes in. A bundle of goodness with all the multigrains, the spices and the fresh ingredients that go into it. It's flavorful to be eaten just by itself. But then if you like some curd, some dahi to go along with it. So typically when you come here and order these, you get two bhakri, you get two thali peet. But because I was tasting so many dishes, I just requested them for one each. Otherwise, a portion of this can make for quite a happy meal at that. Well, I had requested them to just give me a little bit of each, but turns out they have gone beyond the call of duty. So I'm going to only taste a bit from what's on the plate here. So what do we have here? We have some garam puri, of course. We have some shrikhand. When it comes to Marathi food, Maharashtrian food, the shrikhand puri has to be there. We are in summer, therefore that amras. And then there's some basundi and the Bengal gram, the kala chana. So I'm going to make a beginning with the spicy dishes here. So I've got the chana and I've got the aloo rasa. First that aloo rasa. The flavors are quite gentle, quite warming. A good aloo rasa is one where you have the potato that's visible in its presence, but in a manner that is more rasiledar or more liquidy as opposed to solid chunks. And that's exactly the sort of the rasa aloo we have here. I like the freshness of the coriander, the nutty hint of the mustard seeds. So I think these are combinations that you order. There's also tomatoes that go into that aloo rasa. So it gives it that touch of tartness. Out here you can come and order for a combination. So you can decide you want to do the puri, aloo rasa and the amras, or maybe the puri, the kala chana or the basundi. So you can decide the combination that you'd like to savour. But because I'm tasting on behalf of all of you, I think they've ensured that I'm tasting all the possible components that you could call for in a combination. Let's go for that chana now. What I like here is that the manner in which they've cooked the vegetables, whether it's the chana or even the moth bean sprouts that we tasted, it's not cooked to a mush. It still has a bit of its crunch intact. And I always value that when it comes to your vegetables or pulses or sprouts. You want a bit of a crunch in whatever you're tasting. I think we'll taste next some of that basundi. Love the creaminess of it with some of that chironji that you see floating on top of that basundi. I think it will also make for a delicious dunk for my puri. Love it. Next, some amras. Garnish with some, I think, almond flakes there. I think mangoes are just coming into season. Because mangoes are still not plentifully available. This, I think, is made with the pulp. And therefore, when you're tasting mango pulp, there's a slight bitterness that you taste towards the end. And that's what I'm tasting in that amras. Some plain puri just to get rid of that bitterness before I taste some of that Shrikhand. A simple but staple Maharashtrian dessert. I love the thickness of that yogurt. And if I'm not mistaken, they call it the chakka. The chakka, which is basically the strained yogurt. There's some cardamom that I taste in that. Also the crunch of some of the nuts. I think the Shrikhand is loved in Maharashtra, but unfortunately I don't find too much of it outside the state. But it's such a delightful dessert. All that it calls for is yogurt. Yogurt that's strained for a few hours through a muslin. All the moisture escapes to form the chakka that is then sweetened with some sugar, some cardamom and enriched with some nuts. And the sweetness of the Shrikhand gets to you, that puri comes in handy to rein in some of that sweetness, some of that mithas, or as the Maharashtrians would say, some of that godapan. I think goda refers to sweet in Marathi. So I got my puran poli with the sajuk tup. You know me, tuppa in any form gets me going. Oh, that's busy, that's hot. Garam ahe, I think that's what they will say in Marathi. What I love is that they have some ghee here and also some more ghee on the side. That's all somebody like me needs. I will taste it just by itself first. I love the toasty flavors of the wheat. And then of course you're biting into the puran, which is got plenty of jaggery along with that roasted gram flour. And somewhere along the way, you're also tasting the fragrant flavors of the nutmeg or the jaifal. Let's go for it now with some of that toop. I'm going to get plenty of sajuk toop or the pure ghee. That lushness of the ghee spreads itself through that creamy texture of that filling. That's delicious. They've also warmed up the ghee. So the ghee has a nuttiness in its flavors. What I also like is the fact that the sweetness in that puran puli isn't overbearing. So it's a right balance of the jaggery to the gram flour to the poli, that is the bread of wheat and a bit of maida. But what I want to do next is wash down this indulgent Maharashtrian meal with the Amrutalya Chaha, the Maharashtrian Chaha.
So this is made with full cream milk.
Full cream milk, yes. It is like a very quick tea. I mean, जो मसाला डाला है और जो चाय पत्ती वो जल्दी आ जाता है खिल के.
And that's a chai patti.
It's a mix of chai patti, the sugar and the masala.
Okay, that comes from Maharashtra.
Yes, that comes from Pune.
The tea certainly is slightly on the sweet side, and if you like your tea milky, you'll certainly enjoy this Amrutulya Chaha. Well, this has certainly been an interesting afternoon. When I stepped into Mast Marathi, I didn't know what to expect, and to be honest, I'd only heard about the misal pav, the vada pav, etc. But it's been interesting not just to savor the many dishes that I have savored, but to also know of the genesis of this restaurant. Shekhar went to Maharashtra, where he met Swati, and they returned to Bengaluru and began Mast Marathi a year and a half ago to bring to the city flavors that Swati had grown up with, many of the dishes evoking personal memories for her. The flavors that I tasted, whether it's the vada pav or the bhaji pav or the thali peet or the bhakri peetla or the aloo rasa or the shrikhand, were definitely spot on. So if you're looking to savor a delicious slice of Maharashtra in its vegetarian farad and jevan, do check out Mast Marathi here in HSR layout in South Bengaluru. I've enjoyed my meal. I hope you've enjoyed this episode. Until the next time, take care, stay safe, stay very, very safe, and happy drinking.
If you'd like to support the work that we do at Food Lovers TV, do consider joining our membership community on YouTube by hitting the join button below or on the homepage. You could pledge a nominal sum and receive special privileges like behind the scenes footage, shoot updates, access to live Q&As, and a lot more. You could support us on a Patreon page as well. For more info, check out the links in the description below. If you like this video, don't forget to subscribe, like, share, and leave a comment below. Happy eating!